Welcome to the Expat Empire Podcast, the podcast where you can hear from expats around the world and learn how you can join them. Hey guys, before we get to the interview, I want to remind you that we're offering free 30-minute consulting calls to anyone interested in moving abroad. Whether you're thinking about retiring somewhere warm, starting the next chapter of your international career, or even becoming a digital nomad, we're ready to help you think through the next steps in your journey. Send us a message at expatempire.com and schedule a call today. With that said, let's start the conversation. Hey, Josh, thanks so much for joining us today on the Expat Empire Podcast.
Hey, David, I'm glad to be here, man. I've been looking forward to talking with you again.
Yeah, absolutely. It was super fun talking for your show. And I know there's a ton of different stuff for us to talk about. We have some similarities in our experiences and some big differences as well. So excited to get into that. And if you could help me just, and really the audience, by telling us a bit about your background, where you're originally from, where around the world you've lived so far, and where you are right now, that would really help.
Yeah, sure thing. Well, was born and raised in a small town in rural Michigan, and I'm talking a pretty small town. Technically, we're considered a village, you know, about population, 1,100 people, everybody knows everybody. You got to be careful who you ask out on a date because y'all might actually be related, you know, type of small town. And around the time I graduated high school, I made the decision to join the military. I served for 4 years in the Marine Corps. Then following that experience, just tried being a regular college student, got my bachelor's degree in elementary education. And I took that degree and I decided to apply it to the Peace Corps. The Peace Corps has a very large education sector that led me to the Gambia in West Africa to serve for 2 years as a Peace Corps volunteer. But following that experience, I've had a little bit of a paradigm shift. I wasn't really quite feeling the education side of things very much following that experience, mostly just because I became very, very curious. And of course, as you know all too well, David, living abroad yourself, is that having experiences like that leave you much more curious to see what else is out there in the world. So, and I'm sure we'll talk about this a little bit more in depth as we go on in this conversation, but I cultivated that curiosity and I decided to move to England to pursue a different career path. And I decided to settle in on archaeology, you know, just having this amazing experience living with a culture entirely different from my own for 2 years, which again, just really kind of comes with being an expat. I decided to pursue archaeology and I got a master's degree in field archaeology from the University of York. York is situated in the northern part of England. And I've been doing professional archaeology work for about 3 years now. Currently back in the U.S. I live in North Florida. And but who knows? I'm about to go through a transition here before too long, and maybe I'll find myself abroad again.
All right. Sounds great. Well, there's definitely a lot for us to dig into there. But I was just curious. I'm sure we'll get to it at the end. But before we jump to the very beginning of your story, what exactly do you do professionally as an archaeologist? I'm just curious about that career and maybe how it helps you to itch a little bit of that curiosity that you said that you've cultivated over the last handful of years.
Yeah, my current profession does keep me traveling quite a bit. Actually, in fact, just last week, I came back from the U.S. Virgin Islands. I was there for 3 weeks. But much of my work in archaeology centers around what we call compliance archaeology. You know, I work in the federal sector for archaeology. And one of the things that we have to do is on federal lands, they have what's called the National Historic Preservation Act, meaning that before any undertaking can take place on federal lands, whether it's putting in a new parking lot, you know, building a new building, whatever the case may be, the grounds have to be archaeologically inspected first to make sure there's no, you know, cultural heritage remains or human remains in that area that they want to build. And so I will actually go to do testing. Either it's usually with me as part of a team, and we'll go, we'll do varying excavations and surveys just to see what the ground's like. And then after we're done testing, you know, we can kind of give our approval as to, you know, whether or not we think this area is clear of any archaeological remains so they can begin building. So that's primarily what I do. Not really quite as glamorous as what I think many people would think of. You know, I'm not, you know, just barging into tombs looking for that single one artifact that belongs in a museum somewhere. I'm not battling with the forces of evil over these things either. So, but yeah, you know, it's kind of a little bit of an overview, and it does keep me on the road quite a bit, like I mentioned. I just came back from the Virgin Islands after 3 weeks of slugging it out there. I'm actually heading up to Kentucky in a couple of days from our recording for a couple of weeks. And then from there, I'm going to be doing some work in Southern Georgia, possibly bumping back to Mississippi. So,
wow.
You know, so for someone like me who, you know, loves to travel and loves to be on the road, you know, it's pretty fitting. But though sometimes, as of course we all know too well, being expatriates, is that sometimes it could be a little bit weary, you know, give or take,
absolutely.
But very rewarding nonetheless, though. So, but yeah, that's kind of an overview of what I do.
Great. No, that's amazing. I love to hear that. And I'm sure we'll get into it a bit more. So going back to your origins, it sounds like it was quite a small town that you grew up in. So I'd love to know how you got this bug or addiction for being abroad and traveling. And obviously that's a huge part of your life now. So where did it start for you? Where did that first experience happen or the idea into your head?
Yeah, you know, that's a really good point. You know, my small town isn't exactly, you know, a hot spot for world travelers. And, you know, sometimes it can be tricky going back to my hometown after all my experiences and trying to share everything because, you know, there's issues with relatability. Not everyone can relate to what it's like to live abroad, travel the world, you know, which is fine, you know, of course. But I'd say like the initial travel bug had to come from my 2-week study abroad trip that I took in college to Japan. And of course, you yourself, again, having lived in Japan for a couple of years, you know that it is a wondrous place. You know, the cities are amazing. The people are wonderful. The food is delicious. The countryside is just breathtakingly beautiful. And certainly talking up the country pretty well. And for good reason, of course.
For good reason, yes.
Yeah, and that was actually the first country that I visited outside of the U.S. So I definitely got a very, very good experience, international travel experience right off the bat. And this is definitely where the curiosity and the travel bug came from because, you know, this was just one country out of 193 countries out there. And the first one that I've seen outside of my own. And I'm just thinking, well, what else is out there? You know, I got to see what else is out there. And what kind of led me to make the decision to live abroad in the Gambia, West Africa for Peace Corps was, and I hope I'm not getting too ahead of your question here, but you know, when I graduated from high school and of course doing this trip to Japan, this was in my second to last semester. So I was kind of nearing the end of my college experience. So of course the thoughts were coming to mind, well, what am I going to do? I mean, I have to do something after college. And my undergrad being in elementary education, you know, I was looking for teaching jobs, of course, and I graduated from a university in Michigan. Now, at the time, the job market for teachers in Michigan was just in awful shape. I mean, they were closing down schools. They were letting go of teachers left and right. They had much more licensed teachers in the state than they actually had jobs for everybody. So there was a little bit of doom and gloom kind of sort of feeling on the horizon. I'm thinking to myself, well, you know, what am I supposed to do now? I mean, am I going to just do all this hard work for the last few years just to get unemployed? And so I had to start looking at other options and I kind of had to look outward a little bit outside of my home state. And then I'm not sure exactly how I came across the Peace Corps, but as I started looking into the Peace Corps and I was seeing that they had loads of opportunities and they had much need for people with educational experience, you know, something I just so happened to have skills in, you know, I looked into it a little bit more and I ultimately applied. And after a very, very, very long and daunting application process, I was invited to go to West Africa to serve as a teacher trainer. And, you know, that's what led me to my first you know, time living abroad. But yes, it absolutely began with just this 2-week study abroad to Japan. And, you know, I think what led me to choose Japan for my first trip, and of course, the culture is something I was really fascinated to learn about. I'm a martial artist, you know, I grew up doing karate. So of course, hearing stories about, you know, the samurai and the ninja and other, you know, Japanese martial arts styles was something that led me to take interest in that country. And also, this was the first time that this particular trip was being offered at my university. You know, they had tons of study abroad opportunities to, you know, countries in Europe, but not really quite so much in Asia. And so just when I, and when I found out that this particular professor was doing this trip to Japan, I knew I had to capitalize on it. So I was kind of part of the beta test group. And I think he's done several trips following this because it actually went really well. And all the students who went had an amazing time. And as you can tell, for me, it was the type of experience that led me on a path of even more adventures following that.
Yeah, absolutely. And so that was actually after your initial time in the military as well, right? Did you have experiences going abroad for that, or was that more U.S. focused?
Yeah, that was more U.S. focused. I was attached to what was called a non-deployable unit. Long story short is that my unit was what we did is we tested aircraft. There was a particular aircraft called the V-22 Osprey, kind of like a, I kind of describe it as like a hybrid between an airplane and a helicopter. People have probably seen it in movies. It's made the rounds in various Hollywood films ever since, you know, it became operational. My unit was tasked with doing a series of test flights to get this aircraft approved to go operational, to be used overseas, because at the time it hadn't been used in Iraq or Afghanistan. So in order to do that, we had to kind of stay put. You know, they didn't want us like being scattered on deployments. They wanted us focused on just getting this aircraft operational. So, and I say, unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to deploy. Now, some people would say it's kind of strange that, you know, if I was able to stay away from a combat zone during my service, I kind of had it made, which, you know, I'd say, yeah, there's some validity to that. But, you know, I was a Marine and my job was to be of service to my country. And, you know, I think to some degree, I might have would have liked to have the experience of deploying. But of course, you know, I'm 35 now, so I'm well past that, you know, the chances to actually, you know, enlist again and deploy. But yeah, so that's just a little bit of a quick side note on my military service.
Yeah, that's interesting to hear that. Do you think that any of that experience had an impact on your interest in being in the Peace Corps, or was it just completely unrelated in your head? Having done neither of those two things, I'm not sure if there's a connection there, but I just wanted to see if there was any of that in the back of your mind.
No, I wouldn't say necessarily having the military experience led me to do the Peace Corps. However, I will say that many things that I picked up in the Marine Corps were very applicable to my Peace Corps service, or at least going about my Peace Corps service, you know, especially just kind of the discipline and the grittiness, because living in a developing country like the Gambia and living in a rural village way out in the middle of nowhere where you don't have running water, you don't have a lot of modern amenities that, well, quite frankly, many of us kind of take for granted, you know, like electricity, air conditioning, all those creature comforts that were pretty much non-existent where I was living. You know, a lot of the mental toughness that I picked up from the Marine Corps as well, because obviously you go through boot camp and you have really intense drill instructor screaming in your face for 3 months straight, you know, you tend to build up a little bit of resilience. And that's very applicable to not just living in a developing country, but in many other facets of life as well. But of course, so I'd say just the skill set that I've developed mentally definitely went a long way when I was trying to get adjusted to just life in this developing country. And yeah, you know, because it definitely wasn't easy. It's definitely its own unique set of challenges. You know, again, everything from lots of physical discomforts. It was about 107 degrees Fahrenheit most days there. And like I said, I had no air conditioning. You know, I just had like a little hand fan that I would have to just like use vigorously just to try to keep myself cool. And if I wanted to collect water, if I wanted to have water to drink, I would have to collect it. And, you know, there was like communal taps in my village and they would only come on for a couple hours during the day. And for some reason, I found this interesting. They were powered by solar panels. They actually had like a small, like little solar panel set up just outside the village. And so I would have to just take buckets and pails when these water taps would come on. Fill them up, carry them back to my house, run them through their paces. I had to put them through a filter And then actually put a couple drops of bleach in the water too, because water in this part of the world, you know, you can expect to have a lot of waterborne parasites like dysentery and giardia. And I contracted both of those when I was living there. I won't get into the gory details. If anyone's curious, feel free to Google it. But yeah, it's a little bit of a sad story when I contracted both of those things. But yeah, so just to kind of get back to your question, even though there wasn't really much motivation from my Marine Corps service to actually go and pursue Peace Corps, the interest in doing Peace Corps more or less strictly came out of just me being an elementary education major. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, just having this curiosity and this travel bug that I picked up from my Japan experience. And so, yeah, that's ultimately what kind of led me to do that.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. So it sounds like it was a very intense and long application process, and ultimately you were successful. So of course, I want to hear about what the application process entailed. But also, I can imagine that, of course, you passed that, you were able to get this assignment, and other people didn't pass and some did. But were they actually able to tough it out in those situations? Because I can imagine, like you're saying, that your Marine, you know, military experience gave you the mental toughness to be able to go through some of the difficulties that you just talked about. So, is it just a tough route that people really need to think long and hard about if they want to go down that? And, you know, would love to hear just your thoughts on it and the overall application process as well.
Yeah, sure thing. Yeah, I definitely would say that when it comes to becoming a Peace Corps volunteer, character is something that Peace Corps recruiters are going to look very closely into, because yes, it does take quite a bit to commit 2 years of your life to doing this type of service, because that's like the minimum that the Peace Corps is going to ask for is 2 years. And there are instances where some volunteers will even extend longer than that, but the 2 years is the minimum that they'll ask for. And for me, and I'm not sure if Peace Corps has changed their standards since then. This was 2012 to 2014 when I had served. But at the time, I had to have at least a bachelor's degree in order to apply. And I also had to go through like a whole battery of interviews and physical health screenings. I had to go to Chicago for an interview, and that was just for me to even get nominated. Now, when I'm nominated, that doesn't mean I actually have an assignment yet. It just means that I'm just one step further to possibly getting accepted to actually serve in the Peace Corps. And so I had to go to Chicago for my interview. And then after I was nominated, that's when I got like a big packet of a bunch of forms that I had to get filled out by a doctor, and everything from blood work that I needed to get done, immunizations that I needed. And I also had to get some dental screening done as well. And this was just to determine, to make sure that I don't have any physical ailments that would prevent me from being successful. And so it was just a really, really long, drawn out process. It took me almost like a year to apply. Wow. And I think the reason why Peace Corps set it up that way, and of course, I'm just speculating here, I haven't actually really confirmed this, but I imagine that having a bachelor's degree as a requirement and having this lengthy application process, it's their way of determining as to whether or not you're actually committed to doing this. Because, you know, I think the idea is if someone has the willingness to endure 4 years, possibly even more, to get a bachelor's degree and to go through this, they're going to stick it out and go through the rigors of what it takes to be a Peace Corps volunteer while they're actually in country. Because there have been many instances, and I've heard these stories once I actually was serving, is that you'll have Peace Corps volunteers like from the early days when there wasn't, you know, quite so much in the way of requirements, will show up to the airport, are hugging and saying goodbye to their families, getting ready to walk through the security checkpoint, only to actually have it really dawn on them that, oh crap, I'm actually about to, you know, give 2 years of my life to this, 2 years away from family, you know, 2 years over, you know, whatever else that they might be thinking of. And it's really hard to do that. And even though I knew I was committed, there was definitely there was kind of like sort of the fear of missing out of a lot of things, because, you know, the world doesn't stop turning you know, because we decide to go move abroad somewhere. And, you know, relationships that we've might have had can change. You know, you may say no to a couple of potential job opportunities to go volunteer. And, you know, the Peace Corps isn't exactly the most lucrative route financially either. So, and yeah, you know, it's definitely you know, a lot there to become a volunteer. And I guess like the second part of your question for volunteers who maybe didn't have like prior experience like mine with military, right, or whatever, you know, a lot of them did really well because they were very good socially. Like they were just really good human beings, and, you know, they knew how to interact with people. And another big component to being a Peace Corps volunteer, and, well, quite frankly, just being an expatriate in general, is just to have an open mind, because being around and living amongst a culture that may be entirely different from your own. And of course, in Western cultures, you know, like with yourself, having been in Germany and Portugal, you do see a lot of similarities, but there are still some differences. And then, of course, going to a developing country in West Africa, there's a ton of differences, culturally speaking. So just having an open mind to kind of adjust to those, because, you know, you tend to see things that are going to be a bit strange. Mm-hmm. And, but I think one thing that I noticed that a lot of the volunteers that I serve with had done really well is just kind of having, again, that curiosity. You know, they see something that they find strange about a culture, you know, they want to learn more about it, you know, they'll ask questions, and they'll just kind of just immerse themselves, with this culture that they're now a part of. And then when you decide to do that, when you decide to go into those situations, whether it's living abroad, traveling abroad with an open mind, it's very rewarding. You know, you pick up a lot of, you know, there's a lot of things that you pick up that you maybe might've been unfamiliar with before. And sometimes it's getting out of your comfort zone in order to do so, as we know all too well, but it's a very enriching experience, for sure.
So when you look back at that time, how do you feel about the experience overall? Obviously there were a number of challenges and difficulties, an extremely, you know, intensive application process. You were there for the 2 years. You came in with some expectations, I'm sure, about what the role would be. And I think you ended up leaving after, you know, just those initial 2 years, which I suppose is standard. But just curious on, as you reflect on it, what was that experience like for you? And would you recommend it to other people as well?
Yeah, absolutely. And again, it certainly wasn't an easy experience. Lots of challenges, but just like anything else in life, is that the challenging experiences are often the ones that kind of mold us in the way for the better. And we're able to extrapolate a lot of life lessons and I say tools to add to our toolbox, meaning mentally, moving forward as well. And, you know, and I think I definitely would recommend that experience. And it was also just kind of like the experience that just opened up so many other doors for me too. And again, I keep going back to curiosity. You know, curiosity is, of course, just like one of the most basic things that I think we as humans have experienced ever since the beginning. You know, if you think about cavemen who saw the sunset over that mountain range and they wondered what was on the other side of those mountains, so they decided to venture forth, or someone who saw this vast body of water in front of them and tried to build something that would float on it. You know, so when I look back on this experience, and just, again, being immersed with this culture that was entirely different from my own, and trying to learn a language that not even a percentage of the world population can speak. Yeah. I was trying to speak Sarahule. And also the relationships that I developed with my host family. And, you know, my host family consisted of, I had a host father who was married to two wives. Yep, polygamous marriages were a thing. And then also, there was a lot of just embracing a more minimalistic lifestyle that I also found a lot of benefit in too. Like before we hit record here, I was telling you about how when I moved to the Gambia, it was just whatever I could fit into two check bags and a carry-on. And actually, when I came back from Gambia, I had less stuff than what I actually went there with. And it was just a really good eye-opener, because it reminded me that I can do just fine with less, you know. And I think sometimes growing up in a Western country like the United States, I'm not going to say everybody, I don't want to, you know, paint everyone with the same brush, but there's a tendency amongst many people here to be a bit materialistic. You know, we like our stuff. You know, we like our laptops, our TVs, our smartphones, our cars, our, you know, closet full of clothes, and so on and so forth. And I think that there's just this experience just kind of reminding me just to focus on what's most important. And for me, it's not those shiny objects. It's kind of the relationships and the experiences that I can have. You know, I really love the adage, you know, collect experiences and not things. And
right.
And I don't even know if I'm on track with your original question, but I hope you like this response.
No, I like it very much. Please.
Yeah, I hope you like this response nonetheless. And I think about just looking far down the line when I'm at the end of my life, you know, which I hope is, you know, when I'm over 100 years old or something like that. You know, when I look back on my life, I'm not going to reflect on the things that I've owned. Like, I'm not going to think to myself, man, I'm so happy I bought that, you know, fancy new game console, or I'm so glad that I bought that, you know, brand new t-shirt or whatever the case may be. What I'm going to reflect on is the experiences that I've had and the relationships that I developed along the way, where, and I would say, I'm so glad that I committed myself to, you know, being a good boyfriend or a good husband. And I'm so glad that I decided to immerse myself with that culture and got to learn so many fascinating things about them. And, or I'm so glad that I actually just, you know, decided to take the leap to buy that plane ticket when I thought that maybe I didn't have it in the budget to do so. And I went and I had that amazing experience in, you know, wherever it is that I decided to go. So that's, you know, how I really kind of like to live life. I like to collect experiences and not things, because when we dwell so much on, you know, buying up things, they come with a lot of maintenance. You know, if we own a TV, the maintenance comes from the cable bill and paying that monthly subscription to whatever streaming services you want. And then, of course, you know, it costs money to get internet. And then, you know, and if you own a car, it's, you know, you got to do all the upkeep and everything. So all these material possessions that we own, they come with a lot of maintenance and they come with a lot of subscriptions. And so whether it's with your money or with your time to try to, again, do that maintenance. So, and of course, I'm not here to bash anyone who, you know, wants to own stuff. I mean, I like nice things just as much as the next person. But ultimately, it's just I want to make sure and remind myself that, you know, these material things, in the end, a lot of them don't even really matter. It's really just the relationships that I've had with people along the way that I've met. Speaking of like my host family, the teachers in the school that I was called to serve in my village, the other villagers that I met along the way, you know, the other volunteers that, you know, we were going through this tough experience together with. And, you know, those are the things that I really want to, you know, hang on to moving forward and continue to collect those same types of experiences and those same types of relationships moving forward. Again, I don't even know if I even answered your original question, but
no, this was, well, yeah. I think you did. And I think this was even better, but yeah, I do have a couple of things to dive into a little bit there. So you mentioned a homestay experience that you had. So is that organized? Is that a standard part of the Peace Corps volunteer experience? Or is that something that you, through your own initiative, kind of participated in?
Right. Yeah, that's something that the Peace Corps would pretty much already prearrange for you. Kind of the way it works. And again, maybe the Peace Corps may be a little bit different now, but at the time when I went back in 2012, when it comes, you don't necessarily really get to pick which country you go to. You can list regional preferences. And I think at the time, my regional preferences, I'm not sure exactly what they were, but I believe they were Southeast Asia, Central America, and I believe South America. But ultimately, when the Peace Corps sends you an invitation, it's going to be determined on more or less where your skills are most needed.
Right.
And with me having an education background, you know, there was a huge need for education volunteers in West Africa and other parts of the continent. So that's where they invited me to go. And just a quick side note here is that when Peace Corps actually invited me to be a volunteer, it was done very formally. They had FedExed me this big blue envelope with an actual typed out and hand signed invitation letter to kind of outline the assignment that they want me to take part in. And of course, they said the Gambia, and they had all these like supporting documents about the Gambia and the Peace Corps and everything. And so to me, that told me that if I decline this invitation, I highly doubt they're going to take the time to assemble another fancy schmancy blue envelope like this again to invite me to go someplace else. So it seemed like a very now or never type of deal. So
Right.
So ultimately, I pondered on this, and I told myself that not only was just this me trying to, you know, utilize my skills, and of course, obviously, to have a job. You know, I mentioned earlier about how bad the teaching situation was in my home state back then. But I knew that this was a calling greater than myself. And of course, I've had like 4 years of service already in the Marine Corps. And I guess maybe also part of me wanting to be a Peace Corps volunteer was to find a way to continue to be of service to others. And so when I moved there, after, of course, accepting this invitation, the Peace Corps, they've more or less had a way of dividing up my cohort of volunteers. Like you'll go there in groups, kind of scattered at different times. I think my cohort of volunteers, I want to say there was maybe about 17 of us, all education volunteers. And so they clustered us to all travel to the Gambia at one time. And then maybe a few months later, another cohort of health volunteers would arrive. And then agricultural and environmental volunteers would arrive a few months following that. And then maybe they'll do another round of education volunteers. So when we got there, our sector supervisors, you know, they had pretty much already prearranged everything before arrival. They went to the different villages to see if they needed education volunteers. They talked to village elders to see if there was a family that would be willing to host a volunteer for 2 years. And then they kind of gave them a little bit of insight as to what that would entail as far as you know, compensating them financially for hosting a volunteer and having an agreed upon sort of amount that a volunteer would pay them. And of course, that volunteer would get a stipend in order to, you know, fulfill that compensation and that agreement.
Right.
So pretty much everything was all set up for me. I didn't have to do any sort of groundwork to find myself a place to live or to, well, more or less find a job while I was there. And you don't just go straight to your host family. You actually, the first couple of months of being in country is actually more training. You do a little bit of language training. This gives you a chance to get a little bit more familiar with the culture too. And so during that time, you know, you kind of have direct access to, you know, Peace Corps staff, you know, they're right there. Sometimes you may be living around other volunteers, because the way it works is you have training village and then you have your actual village. And so when I was doing my training village, I was living in a village called Madiana. This was kind of closer to the capital, you know, where Peace Corps headquarters was. So that way, again, we had access to staff if we needed them for anything. And then, of course, we were living around other volunteers, so we didn't have to quite deal with the isolation, you know, from being away from our American counterparts just yet. And so that was kind of a way to break us in. And we were living with a host family at the time, you know, again, to kind of get that cultural experience, but it wasn't quite as immersive as, I guess I'll say, quote unquote, the real thing.
Right.
And so once we were done with our few months of training, that's when we were actually legitimately sworn in as volunteers. We had a ceremony at the ambassador's residence in Banjul, the capital city. The U.S. ambassador there, you know, hosted the ceremony at his residence. And then that's when that's when we all dispersed to our prearranged sites, as we call them. And and I guess this is where I wouldn't say my military experience, it bit me in the back, but my supervisor in my sector, she definitely gave me, I wouldn't say like the hardest assignment, but the most remote out of everyone in my cohort. Now, if you were to see Gambia on a map, you know, it's completely engulfed by Senegal. a small portion of it is touching the Atlantic coast, but then it kind of extends eastward into the continent and kind of like a strip. There's the river Gambia that bisects the country right down the middle. And so it's more or less a river with a little bit of land protruding from the north and south extending eastward. So, and Banjul was on the Atlantic coast, of course. And then we were all just kind of scattered as we moved east. And I was the furthest one east from the capital. So I was the farthest away from, I'm not going to say like, well, quote unquote, civilization, right, you know, it's right. Just, you know, and that's also, and I was also the farthest one away from Peace Corps support as well, too. And so since I was the farthest away, seldomly did I get very many visits from other volunteers just because logistically of what it took to get to me. So they felt like, I guess, given that to me, because I guess they kind of felt I was, you know, apt to handle it pretty well. Right. So that was definitely pretty intense. And so if I had to get internet access, the nearest place where I can get it was the city of Basse, which is an 18-mile bike ride. And of course, like I've mentioned, it's 107 degrees most days. Seldomly do you get enough cloud coverage to properly shade you. So trying to make an 18-mile bike ride just so I can, you know, check Facebook and respond to messages was a bit of a daunting process. So I think I handled it well. And I think my supervisor knew I could handle it well. That's why she felt pretty comfortable about giving me that assignment, you know, because this particular village, it was called Baja Kunda, had never hosted a Peace Corps volunteer before. Mm. And the school there, which was a basic cycle school, which is roughly about kindergarten to eighth grade, you know, they were looking to have a volunteer come and work in their school there to help train the teaching staff on like classroom management techniques and various teaching methods. So they, you know, they asked for an education volunteer to come, and they got me. And I think I did pretty well. You know, the teachers seemed to take to me pretty well. Not all of them were willing to integrate some of my ideas or try out some of my ideas, though some were. You know, and that's kind of how I ended up in the village of Baja Kunda. You know, and then of course, again, going back to your original question, I tend to get off on these little side stories. But you know, the Peace Corps arranged everything. You know, it was kind of nice. I just showed up and had a house for me. And then also, what was also cool, I will say this. You know, my house was pretty simple, pretty basic. It was just a square hut, probably about the size of my bedroom that I'm living in here in my townhome in Florida. And my bathroom was a pit latrine in the backyard. And, you know, bad times if I really, really have to go to the bathroom and it's pouring rain outside I have no coverage over that thing. And now, for anyone who's wondering about what a pit latrine entails, just imagine a hole in the ground. I mean, it was a little bit more jazzed up than that. You know, it was completely cemented. And over the hole, there were two foot placements. And I'll just let people use their imagination as what those foot placements were for. But since I was the first volunteer there, you know, this house was brand new. Okay. You know, this pit latrine had not been used before, unlike other volunteers who were stepping in for volunteers that had been there before them. And, you know, the pit latrine has, let's just say, seen a lot of mileage, if you will. And then the house maybe was in need for a little bit of TLC because it was either, you know, having like, let's say, cracks in like the cement, or, you know, the roof needed a little bit of extra thatch, you know, to kind of block out the rain. So for some volunteers, you know, it was, maybe a little bit tougher to get situated, if you will. So that's kind of how that works is Peace Corps pretty much will have your living arrangements and your assignments all laid out for you by the time you get there.
Great, great. Well, it sounds like quite an adventure. I guess that's the best way to put it. So
yeah, for sure.
I'm curious how it all kind of came to a close. Did you plan on just staying for that initial 2 years, or what was your thought process going, you know, into 1.5 years or 2 years in and trying to figure out what was next for you?
Yeah, I'd say by the time my 2 years were over, I was pretty ready to move on. You know, it's just as much as I enjoyed being there, as much as I was of how much I was taken away from that experience, I was certainly ready to move on. You know, it's hard living, like I said, to be there and constantly have to get running, having to collect water and doing all those things. And you know, I was curious to see as to where else, you know, this could take me. And I was, of course, obviously eager to see family. And then, of course, there was this girl that I had been talking to back home that I was, you know, eager to get back and to, you know, see about maybe trying something with her. Ultimately, it didn't work out. But, you know, hey, that's life. Not all things work out the way we hope. So, yeah, I pretty much had made the decision that I was only going to stay for the 2 years, which, you know, I had felt like I had fulfilled my commitment. You know, I was there for 2 years as Peace Corps had asked me to. And of course, I went through all the arrangements to get myself back accordingly. And, you know, but I think going home, that was a tough adjustment because, you know, just being in this rural village in West Africa for this long and just, you know, not having all these modern day amenities, as I'll say, like the electricity, internet, and good cell phone signal, and all those things. It took a little bit to get readjusted to being back in the U.S. I definitely had some serious bouts of reverse culture shock, and also just a lot of just weird feelings. I remember my brother. He had picked me up from the airport when I had flown in. Now, a little bit of a side story here. I had flown in secret so that way I could surprise my family and everyone else back home. Because I had told my parents a certain date that I was going to be flying in. And then, of course, my parents had pretty much told everyone else, yeah, Josh is getting back here and here. We can't wait to see him and everything. But I actually told just my younger brother that I was actually going to be flying in a week sooner.
Nice.
And so he picked me up from the airport in order to forget this, to get this ruse to work is that he picked me up. I had flown in on a Saturday and he picked me up. And so of course I got in kind of late at night, so I couldn't, you know, he couldn't take me directly to my parents' place. So another friend of ours had arranged for me to stay at his place for the night. And my younger brother, he kind of like looked at me funny because I got so excited for actually stepping on carpet, because many of the, cause like my home in, my square hut in the Gambia, I had entirely cement flooring, and with all the dust and sand that I could almost never completely get out of my house. So for pretty much about 2 years, I can't really say I had entirely clean feet because it was just dusty and dirty all the time. And so I step out of the shower there and then I walk out of the bathroom onto carpet. I almost collapsed on the floor and just wanted to like roll up in it because I hadn't stepped on carpet in like nearly nearly two years. So that was definitely a really good feeling, and it was really good to be home. And, you know, and I was really looking forward to being home. And then, of course, let's spoiler alert, I had a huge, huge reveal surprise for my mom and dad. My parents had gone to church that following morning on Sunday, and that was my moment to sneak into the house.
Oh, my gosh.
And then I just stepped out of the room. I just stepped out into the kitchen when my parents walked in, got a really huge surprise reaction from them because they weren't expecting me for at least another week, you know? So for me to show up then, you know, randomly as they came home from church. Yeah. That was pretty exciting for them. So
I'm glad they survived the shock as well.
Yeah. You know, I wasn't sure if I think my mother especially was in a little bit of shock and awe, and she felt it was pretty surreal for her that, yeah, her son just, you know, miraculously appeared out of nowhere just as she came home from church. But yeah, so I was really glad to be home, and I was definitely ready to be home too. And But it did not come without its challenges as well. It's just getting readjusted to being back to life in the U.S. was a little bit hard. And it did take a little bit on my part, too. I kind of had to sort of have a little bit of self-talk with myself because I found myself being, you know, kind of critical of a lot of a lot of people and a lot of things that I was seeing, you know, just for 2 years of just having to go through the whole gamut of just to fulfill basic needs. Like I, you know, I talked about the water and, you know, sometimes I would wait hours for a meal, and the meals that would typically be pretty simple, you know, rice with maybe some vegetables, or sometimes it would be just like a loaf of bread and butter or sombi, which was just rice and that had just been boiled in water, and that was pretty much about it. You know, very, very simple stuff. And but then I come back and then I just see, you know, just sometimes a lot of people getting all worked up over what I felt were just very, very trivial things. Like, you know, the barista at Starbucks gets their order wrong and then they then they flip out on them, or the line is too long at the grocery store and they can't, you know, be patient enough to wait. Or, you know, the food just may take a little bit long at a restaurant because they're really busy, and then people are getting hangry and, you know, demanding where their food is. And, you know, just, and of course I tried to, like I said, I try not to be too critical. You know, sometimes I would find myself saying things in my head like, oh, you poor, poor thing, you. Oh, yeah, yeah, you just had to wait a little extra minute to get this food that someone else made for you, even though you're living like royalty, getting someone to prepare food for you right now. You know, I kind of had to keep myself in check and just kind of remind myself that, you know, this is what they know. This is what they're familiar with. You know, it's hard for them to relate to what life is like for someone far, like hundreds and thousands of miles away from where they are, unless if they've had that experience themselves. But this is their perspective that they had, because this is all they've known. So, so I kind of had to remind myself just not to not be, you know, so critical of people. And then ultimately it's just part of even what Peace Corps' role and one of their objective is to, you know, share stories like this, like the story that you, this conversation that you and I are having, for instance, to kind of just show people and, you know, present to people what life is like for other cultures around the world. And, you know, just maybe that we shouldn't take so many things for granted. You know, I always say that, you know, we may have hard days here in the first world, or as I say, quote unquote, first world problems. And then, of course, you know, and I'm not saying that it's wrong for people to, you know, feel upset or impatient at times. I mean, we're humans. I mean, you know, we naturally experience feelings like that. But, you know, I always just encourage people just to, you know, maybe reflect on the things that you're grateful for, and that you have a lot of things to be grateful for. You know, I think sometimes, and I won't get too deep down this rabbit hole, but, you know, we have a lot of issues that a lot of people are worried about right now. But I think that the issues that are sort of trending right now in this day and age, and again, like I said, I'm not going to really dive deep down on each individual one, but the fact that we're able to complain about those things means that we have it pretty good, because, you know, obviously our basic needs are met, and our basic needs are met in abundance. You know, like most of us, you know, here in the US and, you know, in other places in Europe, you know, where you are, you know, we get to wake up and look up at a ceiling rather than a sky. And, you know, we get to turn on a faucet and have seemingly endless amounts of clean drinking water, where so many people around the world, you know, I mean, the water in our toilet bowls, David, are probably cleaner than what most people have to drink around the world. Well, I'm not going to say maybe most people, but many people. And, you know, we can open up a fridge and a pantry and have a well-stocked amounts of food. And, or like I said, you just push a few buttons on your smartphone and someone's going to bring a ready-made meal to your door. Or you have a grocery store with options up the wazoo of foods that you could choose from. And since we have all of those, I'm going to call them luxuries. And since we have all those ways to fulfill our basic needs, again, in abundance, we have the luxury to actually think about and complain about so many other trivial things, or to, I guess I'll say, get worked up over a lot of issues that, you know, we, that are kind of sort of trending right now in society. You know, I think, cause I think about like my host family in the Gambia, you know, they're not worried about things like politics and all these other things, because so much of their day is spent just making sure that they're collecting enough water, that, you know, they are preparing enough food for their family. You know, it's just every single day, it's just so much goes into just fulfilling basic needs. And then when, and so therefore that's their focus. They're not focused on, you know, what's trending in social media right now. They're not worried about what's happening hundreds of miles away from, you know, where they are. And they're not dwelling on, you know, all these, you know, all these things, because they're quite frankly trying to survive. And so, so that's one thing that I always like to try to share people from my Peace Corps experience is that, you know, you're not wrong for feeling worked up and frustrated with things that happen in your life. You know, we're all, you know, fighting our own battles, but if you have your basic needs met, then you're good to go. You know, you've got your foundationals taken care of. And so that'll set you up well to handle like these tougher situations that you may face. Again, a little bit of a side rant there, but that's just something that, you know, I've learned from my Peace Corps experience that I've integrated into my own life. I like to share it through my own podcast. So I, you know, appreciate the chance to, you know, share it through this platform too, man.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm super happy to hear it. And I totally agree with what you're saying. So I'll let it sit, you know, as you've said it, I won't elaborate on too much. But I guess as we wrap up here, you mentioned your podcast. So I'd love to give the audience here a chance to hear more about that, what the name of it is, where they can find it, what it's about, and what you're trying to do with it, even, you know, more than you've said about it so far.
Sure thing. Yeah, I appreciate that. Yeah, well, my podcast is the All Around Adventure Podcast. It's a mix of travel, adventure, and self-development. I welcome a wide array of different travelers and adventurers on the show to hear their stories. And I also try to extrapolate some of the life lessons that they've learned from their experiences. And, you know, like I said, travelers of all kinds. I have elite warriors on the podcast. I've talked to a couple of special forces guys who have come on my show, you know, scientists, you know, in the archaeology field and in like, you know, the cultural heritage space, expatriates like yourself. You know, you've been on the show, David. So if, you know, our listeners would like to hear kind of a prequel to this conversation, you know, you just been featured recently on the podcast. And yeah, so that's really what it's all about. You know, again, just kind of looking at my own experiences with, you know, living abroad in West Africa for Peace Corps, being a grad student in England, which unfortunately we weren't able to touch on very much today. But, you know, just all these life lessons and experiences that I've learned. And, you know, I wanted to have an outlet to share those with the rest of the world. And as I've met more travelers along the way and through my podcast, you know, I just kind of found that travel and adventure, you know, self-development is a common denominator. So many other travelers that I were meeting, they were talking about the exact same thing, saying, yeah, I've grown so much from my travels and adventures. And just, I've learned so much from interacting with different cultures and stepping out of my comfort zone to experience new and exciting things. And it's been so applicable to other areas of not only my life, but the lives of the travelers that I've had a chance to interact with and interview on my show. So yeah, so that's what the listeners can expect. You know, expect to hear some pretty amazing stories from a wide array of different types of travelers and, you know, get some life lessons. You know, you may want to bring a pen and paper when you listen to the show. And then you can find the show on pretty much anywhere you listen to podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher. You can find it all there. My website is allaroundadventure.com. If you want to, you know, kind of maybe read some of the show notes, and you can also listen to the episodes there as well. I'm also on YouTube if you want to watch the video versions of my conversations with the travelers that I have. I also have a solo cast called Travel Reflections that you could listen to and tune into as well. And yeah, you know, do feel free to give it a listen. You know, I take pretty good pride in putting together all those episodes and getting the content out there for the world to check out. And so I hope everyone likes it.
Awesome. Well, I'll be sure to put all of those links in the show notes and help everyone that's interested to be able to find it. It's definitely a great podcast. Really appreciate the opportunity to be on there myself, and of course to have Josh on the show today. So thank you so much again for being on the show, for sharing all of your insights and really coming at it from quite a different angle from a lot of the other guests that I've had so far. So it's great to get your experience and expertise, and love to see where your travels take you, whether that's within the US with your job now, or maybe some new adventures in the future, and check in and see how things are going. But again, thanks so much for being on the show.
Yeah, I appreciate you having me on, man. Been looking forward to this, looking forward to, you know, reconnecting, and and I appreciate you having me on. I know a lot of legwork goes into preparing for these interviews, so it was nice just to get to show up and just talk.
You know? Yeah, it's so, not bad, right?
Yeah, so I had a good time, man. Appreciate you having me on.
All right, thanks so much. See you soon.
Hey guys, don't forget to like our video, subscribe to our channel, and leave your comment below. You can find us on Facebook and Instagram at Expat Empire. We help people to move abroad through our personalized consulting services. For more information, check out expatempire.com. Thanks, and see you soon.